So we are here at the NCSA's Blue Waters Supercomputer Facility, and we have Director of Communications, Tricia Barker, with us. Tricia, thank you so much for allowing us to visit this wonderful facility. Can you tell us a bit about the history?
The history of the facility and the supercomputer?
Yes,
certainly.
Absolutely.
So the building is now about 4.5 years old. It was built specifically with the Blue Waters supercomputer in mind, although we do have a lot of other high-performance computing, networking, and data equipment and services that run out of this facility as well. Just to give you guys a little bit of history of NCSA and of this facility in particular, NCSA has been around since the mid-1980s. So the first supercomputer we had in 1986, it was great for 1986.
That was the Cray XMP?
It would have been a Cray system, just like the current Blue Water system.
Yes. I was here. I used it.
Excellent. Great. But today, your smartphone is now
much better than
that 1986 Cray, because computers have changed enormously in the past 3 decades. So now when we talk about a supercomputer like Blue Waters, we're talking about something that does quadrillions of calculations every second. In our case, 13 point something or other.
And just in case,
quadrillion calculations per second.
A quadrillion is 10 to the 15th. Okay? That's a big number.
So 1,000 trillion, a million billions, that's the type of number of calculations that we're talking about. If you wanted to do what the supercomputer's doing, you would need millions and millions of years to do what the supercomputer does in a single second.
Now, how does that compare, say, to the computers in our cell phones or our laptops?
So it's a different type of comparison because, of course, your cell phone or your laptop just works independently. And we have hundreds of thousands of processors that are all connected together and working as a team. But roughly speaking, you would need hundreds of thousands of laptops or cell phones.
Because they're more in the megaflop type range.
Yeah.
Right.
And they're not typically networked together and working together, which is the really critical thing with a supercomputer, is get all those processors to work as a team.
On one problem at one time, very quickly.
Yes. Enormously quickly. So Blue Water is currently one of the largest supercomputers that you'll find anywhere in the world. It is freely available for researchers like yourself, not just here at the University of Illinois, but also across the entire country. So people log into the system remotely, people right now from California, New York, Florida, Ohio, you know, all sorts of researchers from all across the country who are looking at lots of different types of problems have the ability to tap into the resources that we have here. So people who are studying climate and weather, people who are studying molecules and diseases, people who are studying
fusion energy. Okay.
Yeah. Well. Lots of different topics throughout science and engineering that people can use this system to do research on. And just to kind of give you a little bit of a preview of what you'll see upstairs, it's a very powerful supercomputer. It's also physically pretty large. It takes up around 5,000 square feet. That's why we needed this new and larger facility to be able to appropriately house that system as well as our other systems. It's also enormously loud, primarily because of the cooling fans that whisk away all that heat that otherwise would build up and destroy all of our lovely processors. So quite loud inside the room. So we'll take you into the room to look around. You'll see lots of big black cabinets and little blinking lights.
Computers, there we go. Yeah, I will see a computer. Okay.
And actually upstairs as well, before we step into the machine room, we'll be able to show you a close up what one of the blades from the inside of the system looks like.
That'll be awesome.
If you're into processors and memory and all of the internal guts of the supercomputer, we can give you a little look at that too.
Oh, two questions. The first is, I know because there's a big supercomputer that the government owns at Oak Ridge National Lab, and there's other ones.
Yeah.
There's always this sort of competition, like who is the fastest, right?
It is.
So where do we rank?
Where we rank is an interesting question.
Aha!
And there's kind of two answers to that.
Okay.
One is that we think the standard way that people look at those rankings is not very useful. So the standard way to rank supercomputers is you run a particular benchmark, and you just evaluate them based on who runs that benchmark most quickly. A benchmark, of course, is just sort of a made-up little test problem. It doesn't represent any kind of real science and engineering research. It's just there to evaluate the computer. And we don't think the current benchmark is very useful in that way. So we've actually chosen not to participate in the ranking. There's something called the top 500 list that comes out twice a year, and it just exists to rank the top 500 supercomputers, or at least the top 500 mm-hmm. that have agreed to play that particular game. So we've pulled out of that and don't rank our system that way anymore. However, mm-hmm. we do know theoretically about where we would land on the list, and we would be, I think we would still be a top five system of all right. the systems anywhere in the world that are used for government research, military research. China and Japan both rank pretty high on the list right now. So we still would be very competitive if we yeah. did participate in
That's
that.
Right. And if it was a better benchmark problem, a problem that actually utilized the types of science, the types of problems that we really want to solve in life and not just some made up kind of stupid thing, we'd probably be number one.
All right. I can't say that, but I will let you say that. And it's interesting you bring up Oak Ridge National Lab. So that's a Department of Energy facility. Most
Jaguar,
of the research
right?
that goes there, it's Titan.
Titan now. That's yes. right. It was Jaguar.
Previously Jaguar. They always have really good names at Oak Ridge. They
yes.
have Kraken as well. That Whoa. Was pretty cool.
Someone likes Magic the Gathering.
But their their system is really similar to ours. They're both Cray systems. They're both pretty much the same generation of hardware. The reason that theirs would rank higher than their than mm-hmm. ours on that particular list is that they use a lot more of the GPUs, the
yes.
graphics processing units. We do have a hybrid system here, so it's a mix of CPUs and GPUs from NVIDIA, AMD CPUs and NVIDIA GPUs. They went much heavier toward the GPU side. And of course, that can do this particular benchmark really, really quickly. But for a lot of our users and the type of scientific mm-hmm. research they need to do, the GPUs aren't always the right solution for them. So right. we stay.
We're not just more. Playing video games. All right.
And of course, they are good now for more than playing video games,
yes.
even though that is their origin. They can be used to really speed up a lot of different types of science and engineering calculations, but not all.
Right.
So since we have to serve a really broad range of users doing lots of different things, mm-hmm. we kept a lot of CPUs as part of our okay. system, and the okay. Titan system leans more toward the GPU side.
I also just want to mention energy use, because
yeah.
this is an energy class. And I think this is a very impressive large building, and basically it's an air conditioner. That if you really look at the amount of volume of this building used for the computer, the other volume of the building used to cool it, I think the cooling volume's larger.
It's an interesting facility because,
yes.
of course, it's specially designed for computer systems. So as large as this building is, you will find not very many people who work here. You don't find a lot of offices. This entire first level where we are now is infrastructure. It's power and cooling systems.
That's right.
So we don't even have any computers here on this level of the building.
Yeah.
It's not until you
The level we go up to is the only floor. This is the only habitable floor. Okay, one floor. And there's a ring of offices along the front,
mm-hmm.
which are kind of nice. There's a control room. But all the rest of the building is devoted to powering or taking the power away from the computer.
Correct.
And if it was a hot day in summer and they were running at full capacity, this building would use, I believe, 24 megawatts.
It actually does not use
no?
24 megawatts.
Okay.
That's currently the capacity that we
yes.
have. So as we're able to expand,
mm-hmm.
we may push up
okay.
to using 24
Okay, you
megawatts.
Could use 24
we
megawatts.
We could conceivably
That's
at this
right.
point use 24 megawatts.
That's right.
Megawatts.
And just to give that in perspective, all of campus uses 80 megawatts. And the fusion device that we just got in our building, which you'll see at some point, uses 2, which is still pretty darn cool. All right, or hot. One
we
of the
did
two.
Have to plan, of course, for that
yes.
energy consumption in designing and building this facility.
Mm-hmm.
So we did some things to try to mitigate that.
Very smart things.
We did, thank you. We do have the ability to do passive cooling here. So there are some water towers. That's not really the right technical name, but I call them water towers.
They're a big tank of water.
They're big 10,000-gallon tanks of water. And on a day when it is cool in
like
Illinois.
Today.
Fortunately, we get cold weather a good percentage of
That's
the
right.
year. We can just let that water get cold and then we pump it in to help cool the computers.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have to actually use a lot of energy to chill the water that we use to cool the computer. Now, on a really hot day in the summer, of course,
exactly.
we are going to have to do that. We're connected to the campus chilled water loop, which is the loop that gives air conditioning to all the campus buildings. So during warmer times of the year, we do have to rely on that, just like other campus buildings do.
Right.
But by using that passive cooling, we cut our energy consumption, our cooling, you know,
dramatically,
budget, really about in half, because we can use that passive cooling around 50% of the year in one way or another. We actually managed to design this building and build it and get LEED certification for this facility, which is a priority for campus now to make sure all new construction is LEED certified. We are a LEED Gold facility.
Okay.
So the second rung, the business instructional facility, is platinum, and we managed to make it to gold, which we're pretty excited about.
But it is also pretty amazing when you think of how big campus is and how many buildings there are. And then there's this one building, and at maximum capacity, this one building can use a third of the energy on campus.
In case you are worried about the electrical bill,
you
do not pay that. That is paid by the National Science Foundation.
Yes.
Everything having to do with the Blue Water supercomputer is paid by grants from the National Science Foundation. So don't worry about your tuition money buying the supercomputer. That actually all is a completely separate line of funding that comes in from grants that we've won.
Exactly. All right, let's go see it.
Sure, let's head on upstairs.
There's our actually part of the cooling system. And as you look to our left, you'll start to see the racks that are full of computer hardware. And then right up here, you can see up close what one of the boards from the system looks like. There are 24 of those in every one of those cabinets. There are 24 cabinets per row, and there are 12 rows of cabinets.
About 5,000 square feet
taken up by that supercomputer.
This is one blade of the Blue Water supercomputer, by some measures the biggest computer and the best in the world. There are 7,000 of these in the machine we're about to see. Of course, one of the key things in making this work is how they're interconnected. And that's what Cray is really good at. These parts are the interconnect. And they're going to connect to the actual CPU processors, which are in this row, and this, and this. And these are all multi-core CPU processors. The bright copper parts are the heat sinks. We've got to take this heat away. We've got to do it efficiently. And then finally, in the middle, is the memory, the RAM, the place where things are stored while being processed on.
So this is it, folks. This giant building is for this one very large room. But if you think about a normal building that would have many floors like this and would have stuff going all the way to the end, we are here because this room can be kept at the right temperature and humidity.
And as we go a little bit deeper into the room, you'll get to see why, part of why the building is so tall. You'll see why it took such a long time to walk up just one flight of stairs. I'll be able to show you the 6-foot raised floor space that we have, where all of the wiring and all of the cooling run under the floor that we're standing on.
Absolutely.
All right.
Follow here. Okay.
Let's go a little bit further into the room here. You can see we do have some other smaller systems here. iForge is primarily for our business and industry partners that we do collaborative work with.
Whoa. This is the memory, this is the storage, tape storage.
This is the tape storage, yes.
Okay.
So what we're looking at right here is taped storage.
One terabyte,
which is 1,000 gigabyte. Drives of memory storage. And when you want to get to it, that robot arm will come down, pick out the right hard drive, and stick it in a slot so you can read it.
So here you can actually see that raised floor space. It's a full 6 feet. So I can actually walk around underneath the floor and I don't even have to duck. And right here you see one of those large water pipes. That's bringing in the chilled water. So during a cold time of year like this, when we can use the water towers, we're just pumping in that cold water, and that's what helps keep the computer cool.
Do you know what kind of flow? How many gallons per something?
I should, but I'm not remembering.
Yeah.
So here we have this 2-foot diameter pipe filled with rushing cold water, all to use to cool the computer. It's amazing. And it's also smart because we're using the outside cooled air, the chilly Illinois winter air, as opposed to electricity from a power plant. In addition, this raised floor, so all the wires can go, means the people that put it all together can just walk around. A crawl space in most homes is narrow, and you've got to crawl through the crawl space. Very smart that you can actually stand up and walk and do your work.
So there's an amazing amount, just miles and miles of cable and connections that go into creating a supercomputer. And because we have this 6-foot raised floor space, all of that can be kept under the floor. And the people who have to make those connections don't have to crawl around in a tiny, uncomfortable space.
So here I am in the bowels of Blue Waters, cabinet after cabinet after cabinet of the fastest processors in the world, solving some of the most difficult problems the world has yet encountered. Global warming, climate change, weather prediction, cancer treatment, fusion energy. So those cabinets over there, that's the spinning disks, right? That's where you have very fast access to memory.
Correct. Kind of your working memory.
The working memory is in all of those.
And then your long-term storage, you go to the tapes.
Long-term storage is in the tapes.
How many people are using it? I mean, are we at capacity or?
Yes.
Okay.
Pretty much. Well, yes and no. It varies.
Right. I mean, there's always something you're going to run.
Right. Oh, exactly.
Right. You're not going to just let it sit.
Idle.
Right. Right.
There are hundreds of people now across the country who have
right.
access to it, but on any given day it could be running maybe 6 different projects.
Right.
But tomorrow it might be 8, and the day
sure.
after it might be 3, because sometimes people are using more or, you know, a larger or smaller number
right.
of the nodes.
Sure. Now, when they talk about nodes, is mm-hmm. that is a blade a node or what?
I believe that we usually refer to a blade as a node. Yeah.
Okay.
If the cooling system breaks, how long would it take?
I remember once a major utility line going into the computer applications building where the
yeah.
was, you know, I don't know, some backhoe like cut into the line, and I know I at least had it, something crashed at that point.
Yes, and we apologize.
No, I understand. Can't plan for backhoes.
Right.
Call Julie before you dig. All right.
Wise words.
Yes.
And of course, we can't really have a backup generator, and it would be large enough, or a USB system that would be large enough to just continue to run the supercomputer if there were a total power disruption. So if all of our sources of power are disrupted, nothing's happening.
Right.
It shuts down.
Yeah.
We don't have a magic way that we keep running if there's a huge power outage.
That's right.
This building, though, is designed to withstand at least an F3 tornado, some level of earthquake. So we took disaster preparedness into account in the design.
And then what happens if there is a fire? What kind of fire suppression system
the
is that?
The fire suppression is actually water.
Okay.
It's a double action system, so those pipes are dry. They're not going to accidentally leak on anything
right.
in there. You really have to melt part of the sprinkler head before we dump water on the ground. And we do operate this as a 24/7, 365 facility. Always human beings are on duty here in the building. So they're available to kind of monitor things like
right.
water leaks, smoke, fire, security cameras, in addition to their role in helping people who use the supercomputer get answers to their questions, get help
right.
with any problems they
That's
have.
Right. Because I noticed in some previous systems they use like halon. And
yeah.
and if you don't know what that is, it's a gas that fills and displaces all the oxygen. The problem with that system, it also would kill firefighters, right? And
I
you know,
probably would not take you into the room
if
you're still using halon.
Exactly.
You wouldn't want to risk taking you in there if that were
yeah.
the case.
And
you might have actually noticed as we walked down the row there that there are a lot of exit doors. every single row of the computer hardware there has its own exit door because there's such long rows. That's actually required for human health and safety. You have a quick way to get out in case of any sort of disaster. You don't have to run a strange maze to get out.
Oh no, I'm trapped in the labyrinth! Yeah, it's also smarter. You think using water for something electrical, but you know, you got a fire on, probably turn the thing off, all right? And a lot safer than Halon, because what if it's just one little thing and someone could come in with a fire extinguisher or a switch and turn it off? The whole thing's filled with, I mean, yeah.
I would say that, you know, fire is actually worse for a computer than it's in water, so.
Yeah, look, and people coming out of the floor. I love it.
All right. I told you it was a sixth grade floor.
That's right.
Demonstrating that action.
And now the control room over here, which is also kind of cool to look in.
Yeah, this is the control room here. You can wave to our help desk staff. But they are wonderful. At least one of them is here 24/7, 365. You know, anytime that someone calls or emails, you're always going to be able to reach someone here. So if you do have a problem or a question, as you're using Blue Waters or any of the other systems, you know, they're going to be able to help you. They're going to be able to kind of direct that to the right team of people at NCSA who can help you with whatever your problem or question is.
That's great. Well, thank you very much.
Yeah,
appreciate it.
So much.